On Saturday, in Clichy, France, Garry Kasparov showed that he's still a great chess player. The former world champion played a match against Maxime Fachet-Legraf. The match was part of a bigger event which promoted the Kasparov Chess Foundation's work with chess in schools. Fachet-Legraf earned the right to play Kasparov by beating Fresinet. In a qualification match to play against Kasparov. Fachet-Legraf is an opponent worthy to play such a game. He is French number one and a French national champion. Furthermore, he won the 2010 European Blitz Championship, so he is definitely a super tough opponent. But would he... Would the former world champion who retired from chess, so who spent less time on chess, and be up to the task to give Fachet-Legraf, the young, talentful, and European Blitz champion from 2010, a run for his money in a 5-minute plus 3-second increment match? Well, let's find out. This is the first game from their match, and Kasparov had white, and he started with e4, and Fachet-Legraf answered with c5. So we get a Sicilian, and after d6, Kasparov plays an anti-Sicilian with bishop b5. This is called the Moscow variation. And, well, the reason to play such a system is to dodge all the super theoretical main lines and play, well, something different. Somewhat more surprising. And bishop b5 thereby was played. And knight c6 was played to block the check. But more usual is bishop d7. When after takes, we have queen takes, and then the knight can come to c6. But Fachet-Legraf played knight c6, which is less natural because he puts his own piece in a pin. Kasparov castled, and bishop d7 was played, depinning the knight, developing the bishop. And now c3 was played. So this is to prepare for a d4 push, and well, it gains control over the d4 square. In some cases, it might even give the bishop a nice square on c2. Fachet-Legraf played knight f6, attacking the pawn, which was defended by Kasparov by rook e1. a6, putting a question to the bishop, which went back all the way down to f1, and here it has the potential to come back in the game later, while also being a defender of the king, defending g2, and really with bishops it isn't a real problem to push them down to the last rank, because bishop, as I said in other videos, are pieces who like to shoot from a long distance, and thereby from a back rank they are able to more easily come back into the game than other pieces. Bishop g4 was played by Fachet-Legraf, pinning the knight and of course, thereby putting more pressure to the center. H3 to question the bishop. And here Fashey de Graaf made a questionable choice by playing bishop takes f3, giving away the bishop pair. Well, bishop h5 is quite playable, but as said, bishop takes f3 was played, not wasting any time and just taking the knight. Queen takes f3, and now g6 to develop this dark squared bishop on this nice long diagonal. And we see that black really is playing on these dark squares with his pawns, his knight, and also that bishop coming to g7, and eventually maybe even the knight to d7 and e5. Here Kasparov played d3, which reinforces e4 and also frees the d2 square for the knight. And he waits for the d4 push when it's the right moment to play it, so when it has more of an impact. So now Fashey de Graaf just went on developing bishop g7. Kasparov played bishop e3, which is a very strong posted there, as it can't be really attacked with all the domination on, for instance, g4, and well, the other fields like d5, or any other field where a knight would like to attack the bishop. The knight drops back to d7, as said, reinforcing the dark squares, also freeing the f pawn for a later push. Knight to d2, a normal developing move. Black castled. And now the queen went back to d1. This has two reasons, I think. One is that here, back on f3, after an f5, it has this tension with the rook on this f file, which is unpleasant. And it also frees the white f-pawn to go forward to f4. Rook c8 was played by black. Also interesting is, for instance, b5, which was played before. And then after a3, rook b8, we get a game which was played by Kasparov as well, in a game against someone called Patterson, rated 2540 in Reykjavik 2004, and Kasparov won that game. But as said, this b5 move, gaining space on the queen side, wasn't played. What Fashey de Graaf played was a new move, rook c8. And we get f4 from white, the move which was prepared for by white. And e5, a central push, and but also weakening the light squares. And Kasparov directly gets rid of the tension in the center and starts a kingside space gaining maneuver, and also an attack on the black king with f5. After g takes, e takes was played, and now d5. So we see Vacher Le Graeff gets a strong center in exchange for this potential attack on the king side from white with g4 now. E4 was played, so here Vacher Le Graeff really goes for the central attack, and Kasparov just moved his bishop to a post of which he thought was more useful for it with bishop f4, so better defending the black squares behind the pawns. And for instance, this e takes d3 is nothing for black, just bishop takes, and white is doing rather well. So knight e5 was played. And now d takes e4 was played. So black sacks this pawn for this dangerous attack in the center. And well, Kasparov played g5, so ignoring this central push and just keeping going on the king side. Rook e8, and now queen h5. This is a dangerous looking move with this queen coming near the black king, and especially in a blitz game, it's a nice move to play, just because of the psychological effect of it. D takes c3 was played by Vacher Le Graeff, and just b takes by Kasparov. And now knight to d3. This is a very strong knight, and Kasparov thereby decides to get it off the board, and now plays f6, attacking the bishop, and also gaining some vital control over g7 and e7. Queen to f3. This move, well, it's understandable because Kasparov is pawn up, so exchanging queens might be a good idea, especially when this black queen is in such a dangerous position, but also gives away the initiative. So probably not the best move from white. Better, for instance, I think, is rook c1, just defending the c pawn and still having some prospects for a good kingside attack. But as I said, queen f3 was played, c4 defending the queen, and Kasparov removes the queens, and then plays e5, reinforcing f6, gaining some space in the center, and freeing the e4 square for a white knight, for the white knights. Knight d8 was played, preparing to come to e6, where it blocks the e5 pawn, and it also attacks this bishop and the g5 pawn. So e6 would be a very strong post for the knight. Knight e4 and knight e6. And well, this is a move in style of a Nimzowitsch. And well, Kasparov replied with bishop e3. And now rook d8 by black. So we see this pawn on the third rank, which is quite dangerous and quite annoying for white. And Kasparov thereby puts pressure to it with rook d1. And Vacher Le Graeff played rook d5, attacking the pawn. And here Kasparov instead, well, here, no, Kasparov has a real option. He has to give back the pawn, and he decides to play bishop d4. And after knight takes, pawn takes, rook takes, Vasily Grav won his pawn back, but we see that Kasparov still has this strong phalanx here on the king side, and this strong knight ready for an attack. King f2 was played, so, well, with less pieces on the board, getting the king more active. Rook to e8 and rook to e3, getting ready for this maneuver to e7, and firstly f5, of course, and also defending the pawn on e5. Rook d5, putting pressure to the pawn, and h4, defending g5, and maybe preparing h5. Bishop b4, getting ready to play the bishop to c3, and also attacking the rook. On c3 it would attack the e5 pawn. So rook e4, attacking the bishop, bishop c3. Now the pawn on e5 is attacked 3 times and only defended once. So, but Kasparov just plays knight f5. Threatening check. And that's why Vasily Grav played king f8. Another option was to take the pawn. After takes, takes, knight h6, king f8. We just get rook d3, winning the pawn back. And with a more than comfortable position for Kasparov. So, because as we see, this rook is tied to the defense of this pawn. So that's important. That's why knight f5 was possible and king f8 was played by black to get rid of a potential check. Knight e7 still was played. A nice post for the knight and also attacking the rook, which moved to d4. And here Kasparov had the options to exchange rooks, but, well, important is when you have the option available to exchange is to ask yourself, will it benefit you? And here Kasparov didn't thought so and played king f3, so getting his king more active and also defending the rook. After rook d8, now we get the exchange, the difference being that the king now is on f3. And knight moves back to f5, attacking the rook and defending h4. The rook moves back, also attacking the pawn, and rook e2 was played. Of course, if black would take this pawn, we get rook d3, and, well, white here has the better game. So, after rook d5, yeah, knight e3, attacking the rook, rook d4, attacking the h-pawn, but knight f5 back. And instead of making a draw, Kasparov here thought, well, I think I have good chances. And he played rook c1, attacking the bishop, and when it moves, it has a strong check on c8. Black really has one move, bishop a5, because after rook c8, the check can be blocked by bishop d8. Note that after, for instance, bishop d2, we have rook c8, which is a check. The king can't move off this 8th rank because of this pawn attacking these squares. So after rook d8, rook takes, it's checkmate. So that's why bishop a5 is only move, and after check, the bishop can come in between. And after h5, we see this phalanx really becoming an active weapon, and he starts pushing these pawns. King e8 was played, defending the bishop, but now this gives the opportunity for e6. And probably white here, black here is able to take this pawn. And after rook b8, rook d7, still white has an advantage because these pawns are super strong, but this would have been playable. But here Fischer de Graaf played d2, and this is really a blunder, because now as you see, after e7, getting a queen won't help, because after knight takes, rook takes, we have h6, and now we get this cunning idea by Kasparov. This bishop is in a pin, he's going to win it eventually, and thereby he waits with winning this bishop by using his phalanx now to really demolish black. Rook d6 was played, and here Kasparov played some moves with his king, and when he decided his king was on a good square, or black did so by playing b5, which again isn't the best move. Better is to try to keep and check the white king, because now we get a really strong move g6. And well, really pause the video and try to find why this is such a strong move. Well, the answer is this. We have h6 g6, but this is no good because h6, and we have a mate in full forced. Black is able to play some checks, but then afterwards he will be checkmated. So what else is there to play? Well, this pawn has to be stopped, so only move is f takes g6. But now see the little but nasty combination Kasparov played. Pause the video, give you 5 seconds, and then find this super strong combination by Kasparov. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The final blow was this. E takes e8, queen, check. Has to be taken by the rook. And now, the really strong final move, the final blow. And remember, black was Fischer de Graaf, 2010 Blitz European champion and French national champion, number one French player on rating. And Kasparov retired, but still super strong player played here, f7 check, and Fischer de Graaf resigned. The point being that if he takes the pawn, the rook will be taken, and well, he's in check, so he has to move his king. If he tries to defend his rook, we just get rook takes, king takes, and promoting to queen with a forced checkmate in 7. So a really great game by Kasparov. He showed he still is one very strong player, and well, arguably the strongest chess player who ever lived. Retired, but still super strong. Played this very nice game. The second game was drawn, so Kasparov won this Blitz match against Fischer de Graaf. And well, it's just great to see that this legend of chess is still such a strong player, and he can still produce such nice games and, well, nice combinations to win a game. I hoped you liked this game as that I did, and any comments, questions or requests here on YouTube are appreciated, as well as thumbs up. Thank you very much for watching, take care and bye.